إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله، ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم، منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون. وقال تعالى أيضا: ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost I enjoin upon myself and then all of y'all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a believer attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, he reports that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ بَدَأَ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَأَ فَطُوبَى لِلْغُرَبَى. قِيلَ وَمَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ؟ قَالَ الَّذِينَ يُصْلِحُونَ إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسِ. صححه الألباني. This hadith is narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that indeed Islam began as something new, something strange. وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَى, and it will go back to how it began. In other words, it will go back to how it began as something new, as something strange. فَطُوبَى لِلْغُرَبَى. So let طُوبَى be for the غُرَبَى. I will translate it as we go further. قِيلَ وَمَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. It was asked from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as to who are these individuals, ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, الَّذِينَ يُسْلِحُونَ إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسِ. They are those who put things right, who reform themselves, إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسِ, when people have gone astray. And this hadith is صحيح by Imam Albani rahimahullah. So inshaAllah ta'ala, the title for today's khutbah is Al-Ghuraba, the strangers. Today's khutbah inshaAllah ta'ala is going to evolve around who are these strangers, who are these fortunate strangers, and what are the distinguishing qualities that have been ascribed to these privileged strangers. May Allah the Almighty Make us all from the ghuraba. Make us all from these fortunate strangers. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in the very hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. Let Tuba be for the ghuraba, be for the strangers. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anh is reported to have said that Tuba has two meanings. The word Tuba in the hadith has two meanings. One meaning is that it means let glad tidings be unto these strangers. Allahu Akbar. Let glad tidings be unto these strangers. And the second meaning that can be given to Tuba is that Tuba is a special tree in Jannah. Allah the Almighty has created this tree in such a way that the shadow of that tree, it would take a rider, a fast rider on a horse, 100 years to cover the shadow of that tree alone. Allahu Akbar. So let that blessed tree be for the ghuraba. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in other words, what we are trying to say is that Islam will go back to how it began. And how did Islam begin? How did Islam begin? Islam began as something new, something strange. The followers of Islam in the beginning were weak individuals. They were the poor individuals. They were slaves. Whoever accepted Islam at that time was considered a strange person. But afterwards, Islam grew. Islam spread to the far corners of this earth. Islam became one of the most powerful religions. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he does not speak out of his own desires, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has informed us is indeed divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He informs us that Islam will go back to how it began. Allahu Akbar. And at that time, the individuals who strictly adhere to Islam, they will be looked at with a strange eye. They will be looked at as strangers. They will be looked at as if they are funny people. But at the end of the day, they are the ones, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, who will be known as al-ghuraba. Hadith is in Muslim. Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu anhu narrates, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is reported to have said, إن أمتكم هذه جعل عافيتها في أولها. Indeed, this ummah of yours, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is addressing the Sahaba, رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين. And likewise, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is addressing us through this hadith. إن أمتكم هذه, this nation, جعل عافيتها في أولها. It's good times. In other words, the safe times and eras were in the beginning of this nation. وَسَيُصِيبُ آخِرَهَا بَلَاءٌ وَأُمُورٌ. The latter stages of this ummah will face many trials, many tribulations. تُنْكِرُونَهَا وَتَجِيءُ الْفِتَنِ وَتَجِيءُ الْفِتَنِ. Fitna after fitna, trials after trials, tribulations after tribulations will afflict the latter stages of this ummah. فَيُرَقِّقُ بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا ثُمَّ تَجِئُ الْفِتْنَةِ فَيَقُولُ الْمُؤْمِنِ هَذِهِ مُهْلِكَتِي هَذِهِ مُهْلِكَتِي. It will go to such an extent that trial after trial would begin to afflict the Muslim ummah, so much to the extent that a believer at the outset of a trial, he would look at the trial and say, this trial is going to destroy me. This trial is going to bring about my doom. But then that trial would vanish away, and then another trial would come. And then he would look at that trial and say, هذه مهلكتي هذه مهلكتي. This trial is going to destroy me. This trial is going to bring about my doom. But even that trial would pass away. And then again another trial. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say in that very hadith, my dear respected brothers and elders in Islam, along the lines of these words, that the one who wants to save himself from the fire of Jahannam at that time, let him be an individual, that death comes to him when he believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strongly, firmly, and in the last day. That individual will be saved from the blazing fire of Jahannam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, coming back to Al-Ghuraba, there's another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's reported to have said, إِنَّ مِنْ وَرَائِكُمْ أَيَّامَ الصَّبْرِ إِنَّ مِنْ وَرَائِكُمْ أَيَّامَ الصَّبْرِ لِلْمُتَمَسِّكِ فِيهِنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ بِمَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرُ خَمْسِينَ مِنْكُمْ. That indeed, after all, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is addressing the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Indeed, after all, there are days of patience where the people of that time, of that era, will have to bear a lot of patience due to the sufferings and trials they will have to endure. لِلْمُتَمَسِّكِ فِيهِنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ بِمَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرُ خَمْسِينَ مِنْكُمْ. And for the one who strictly adheres to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for that individual will be a reward equivalent to 50 of y'all. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressing the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, telling them, informing them that there are days after you, there will be a time after you where there will be so many trials, so many afflictions, that the one who strictly adheres to the teachings of Allah and His Rasul, for him is a reward equivalent to 50 of y'all. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Nabi Allah, awa minhum, will it be equivalent to 50 of those individuals? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarifies, Bala, aw bal minkum. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarifies, no, rather it will be from 50 of y'all. Allahu Akbar. Bal minkum, rather the reward will be equivalent to 50 of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Imam Al-Awza'i, rahimahullah, he mentions in regard to the hadith that I read in the beginning, إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ بَدَأَ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا, that indeed Islam began as something strange and will go back to being something strange. But that does not mean that Islam itself will disappear. Nay, rather the true followers of Islam will diminish, the numbers will dwindle, so much to the extent that only a tiny minority will remain who will be the true followers of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, he says that at that time, if you hear, that is, I would say in our times, Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah clarifies, if you hear about an individual who strictly adheres to the teachings and the sunnah of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let him be from the east or the west. What he's trying to say is, let him be from either one of the four corners of the world. Pray for him. Pray sincerely for him as the true followers of the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are extremely few in number. Today we live in a time where most of us, we suffer complexes to look like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We suffer complexes to follow our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We follow other people. For example, if we were to take the sunnah of the beard of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if a celebrity, if an actor, if a sportsman, an athlete were to grow the beard and it becomes a fad, it becomes a style, it becomes a trend, then all of us, we are ready to follow that particular actor or celebrity. But on the other hand, knowing that it was a sunnah practiced by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, commanded by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many of us remain oblivious to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we were to take Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advising us on wearing our dresses, our clothes above the ankle, if some fashion expert comes and tells us, no, your trousers need to be just past your ankle, we are ready to follow his advice, hoping to make it to the cover of Vogue magazine. But we aren't ready to follow the instructions of our beloved teacher, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We live in a time where the minute an individual starts following the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is looked at as a strange man. He is looked at as if he is doing something strange. But at that moment, remember, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, فَطُوبَى لِلْغُرَبَى. Let glad tidings be unto those strangers. Allahu Akbar. Like I mentioned earlier, the ghuraba, they will be a minority. They will be few in number. The reason being, the true believers from the people of Islam will be very few. And from those true believers, the scholars of Islam will be few in number. And from those scholars, true scholars who are upon what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in were upon will also be few in number. Few in number. Now, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we move on to the distinguishing qualities that have been ascribed to the strangers, al-ghuraba. Quality number one, the primary distinguishing quality of the ghuraba is, as Imam Ibn Rajab rahimahullah says, al-ghuraba qisman. These strangers are of two categories. These strangers are of two categories. He goes back to the hadith I read in the beginning. They will be either category number one, مَنْ يُصْلِحُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ فَسَادِ النَّاسِ. When times are corrupt, when people have gone back to evil ways, when people are immersed in innovation, in sins, in transgression, in why? These people will put themselves alone right. They will reform themselves alone. They are a category of the ghuraba. And category number two, they are those مَنْ يُسْلِحُ مَا أَفْسَدَ النَّاسِ. Allahu Akbar. They are those who will not only reform themselves, they will not only suffice by reforming themselves, they will also put right what others have put wrong, what others have brought in as innovations, as sins, transgressions, etc. They will not only suffice to themselves, rather they will be worrying about their brothers in Islam, they will be worrying about their neighbors, they will be worrying about their family members, and so on. And this is why this nation has been distinguished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the noble Quran as khayru ummah. The ayah I recited in the beginning, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. Why are we known as the best of nations? Why? Is it just because we reform ourselves? Nay, we are known as the best of nations due to the fact that we enjoin good and we forbid evil. We enjoin good and we forbid evil. The other ayah I recited in the beginning, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. There should be, or let there be a nation from amongst y'all, a group from amongst y'all, who calls towards good, who invites towards good, who enjoins good and forbid evil. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. For indeed, they are the most successful individuals in this world and the hereafter, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Quality number one is that they do not suffice to reforming themselves alone, but rather they worry about the whole ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as that was exactly the worry of our teacher Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next quality in regard to ghuraba is that they will strictly adhere to the aqeedah of our Salafuna Salih, our pious predecessors. They will strictly adhere to the clean, pure, correct aqeedah of our Salafuna Salih. Their belief, their creed will be straight. It will not be filled with innovation. We do not worship anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not bow down to any grave, any stone, any stick, nothing other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This aqeedah will be the aqeedah that they follow, the aqeedah of our Salafun al-Salih, our pious predecessors. Sadly, we live in a time where many of us are not even aware of what is aqeedah, what is the creed that we believe in. Many of us, we aren't aware. There are many factors that need to be discussed, but the platform of khutbah of the Friday sermon will not suffice. Rather, each one of us, we need to find true scholars of Islam, go by them and study what is the proper aqeedah that we need to be following. The next quality is that they will strictly adhere to the teachings of Islam. They will strictly adhere to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether it be in regard to their salah, in regard to their Ramadan, in regard to their zakah, in regard to their hajj, in regard to all of their ibadat, mu'amalat, mu'asharat, all of this. They will strictly adhere to what is halal, what is haram. We live in a time, most of us, we amass millions. We don't care whether the source is halal or haram. As long as the money is credited into our account, that's all we are worried about. Even if we were to take the season of vacations and holidays, the brother is extremely religious, but when it comes to a holiday, when it comes to a vacation, all of the piety, all of the strict observance is out of the window, and he goes and indulges his vacation in perhaps a resort or perhaps a hotel where the food is not even halal. And some brothers come up with the logic that we are going towards perhaps down south and the restaurants are only seafood. Only seafood. So why do we have to worry about whether it's halal or haram? It's only seafood, fish, prawns, crabs, etc. So why do we have to worry? My dear brothers in Islam, at times these hotels, these restaurants, they mix the food. You have lobster in red wine. You have lobster in white wine. Many of us are not aware of this. It is the same wok that is used to fry that lobster, which will be used again perhaps to make your devil prawn curry. There will be remnants of wine in that dish. It is haram. The ghuraba will be those who strictly adhere, who will find out, who will go through the pain to check whether it is halal or haram before they indulge even in a vacation. They will be those individuals who strictly adhere to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next quality in regard to the ghuraba is that they will keep on taking account of themselves. Umar radiallahu anhu is reported to have said, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Take account of yourselves before you are taken into account. Audit your books before your books will be audited for you. Every single day, take audit of yourself. Have I spent my time properly in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or Allah save us all in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبَ وَعَابِرِ السَّبِيلِ. Be in this dunya or live in this dunya like a gharib. Once again, the same words as the main hadith. As a stranger or a passerby. Because this dunya, this worldly life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with is a darul mamar. It is not a darul maqar. It is a darul mamar. It is a transitory stage. It is a stage which is passing by. It is not a place where we have come to permanently reside or live in. So it is upon us to live as a stranger, for our destination is al-akhirah. This is just a transitory stage we are passing by. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the noble Quran, اقترب للناس حسابهم وهم في غفلة معرضون. for mankind, his time for taking of accounts has come close. It is upon him. It is just in front of him. But sadly, وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مَّارِضُونَ. He is neglectful and he has turned away heedless. The day of Qiyamah is extremely close by. None of us can guarantee that we would even last to reach our homes today. Perhaps we have just got 1 hour remaining or 2 hours remaining. None of us know how much time we have got left. When Malakul Maut comes and stands in front of us, at that time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Tawbah will not be accepted from us. Do any one of us know when Malakul Maut is going to come visit us? Scary reality, by the time we reach home, Malakul Maut may be waiting for us. But are we ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is the question we need to ask ourselves. And that is how we need to take account of ourselves. The next quality in regard to the ghuraba is that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that these ghuraba, they will strictly adhere to the doctrine of al-wala and al-bara. Sadly, many of us, being Muslim, we are not even aware of the term al-wala and al-bara. Whilst al-wala and al-bara is the fundamental principle that la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah is based on. Al-wala and al-bara. Loving and hating for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your loyalty and your disloyalty. Let me explain in the few minutes that I've got remaining. As most of the individuals were in the hype of cricket a few weeks back, let's look at an example, a hypothetical example from the game of cricket. You have a Sri Lankan team and an Indian team. My knowledge about cricket is very nil, but I'll do my level best to put the example in clarity. You have a Sri Lankan team and an Indian team playing. We, being Sri Lankans, we are supporting the Sri Lankan team. Let me ask you all a question. The minute the Sri Lankan team wins, if one of us were in the game at that time, or say one of us, we are one of the players in that team, will it be proper that if the Indian team wins, we start cheering and we start shouting and screaming away in happiness? Will it be proper? Or on the other hand, when the Sri Lankan team wins, will it be proper if we look downtrodden and saddened by that? Will it be proper? Are we showing our loyalty to our team? Take a football match. The minute the opposing team hits a goal, if we start cheering and shouting, what will people think of us? They might think of us as a madman. If we are in a team and we cheer for the opposing team, does that sound logical? Does that sound logical? It isn't. We, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we all of us are in the team of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. The enemies of Islam want us to be on the team of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, but cheer for the opposition team. Is that proper? Is that proper? In regard to our loyalty and our disloyalty, are we supposed to be loyal to our team or loyal to the opposing team? We as Muslims, we have embraced the culture of the enemies of Islam with open arms. We are not being loyal to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. No, we are loyal to the opposing team. We have embraced their culture with open arms. We want to dress like them. We want our women to go around exposing like their women. The culture that is being promoted today is a culture of voyeurism and exhibitionism. Voyeurism, we men are being taught to look at whatever we want, wherever we want, however we want. On the other hand, women are being taught the culture of exhibitionism, to show more and more flesh to get what they want, to get the attention that they want, totally contradicting the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. ذلك أزكى لهم إن الله خبير بما يصنعون. قل للمؤمنين, say unto the believers, يغضوا من أبصارهم ويحفظوا فروجهم, that they are supposed to lower their gaze. Totally contradicting the culture of voyeurism. We cannot look at what we want, how we want, where we want. No. Lower your gaze. Protect your private. ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ. Our Maker informs us, ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ. That is more pure for them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is most aware of all that they do. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is in regard to a few qualities of the ghuraba. These are the distinguishing qualities that make these people, these individuals, the ghuraba, so special in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The final closing note. It is a statement of Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He says, in regard to the main hadith that I read at the very beginning, he says, لَمَّا بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا لَا يُعْرَفُ, that when Islam began, it began as something strange, something new, something that not many people knew of. ثُمَّ ظَهَرَ وَعُرِفُ, and then it grew, it became powerful, it became famous. Everyone, the four corners of this world, came to know of Islam. Likewise, فَكَذَلِكَ يَعُودُ, Islam will once again go back to that strange state, حَتَّى لَا يُعْرَفْ, until it becomes something strange, until it becomes something unknown, until people do not recognize about it, ثُمَّ يَظْهَرْ وَيُعْرَفْ, and then once again, Islam will raise its head, and Islam will once again become the most powerful power. And then it will become known all over the four corners of this planet. And then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, every single true believer, every single stranger, every single one of the ghuraba will indeed be the victorious one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the noble Quran, كتب الله لا أغلبن أنا ورسلي إن الله قوي عزيز. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written, لا أغلبن أنا ورسلي, that I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this, Allah has decreed it, that I and my messengers will overpower everything. Allahu Akbar. Inna Allaha qawiyyun aziz. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is the most powerful, the most exalted in might. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that fills our hearts with hope, that do not be belittled by all of these external forces that are trying to make us look insignificant. They are trying to eliminate us, but that is never going to happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed victory for the Muslims, but it is upon us to be strong on what we are upon what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in were. If we do that, we will indeed be from the special ghuraba who will be victorious in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill all of our hearts with taqwa. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the ghuraba, the special ghuraba who will be victorious in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make it easy for us to bring those special qualities in our lives. May Allah the Almighty help us to emulate our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 100%. And may He the Almighty unite all